Welcome to r/maliciouscompliance, where we share stories of people conforming to the letter, but not the spirit of a request. And today's first story is, of course the judge can read it. I'm a clerk at a civil court in Brazil. My job includes dealing with lawyers and parties who walk up to our counter, as well as dealing with all the stages of a lawsuit. A civil clerk's day-to-day work consists in mostly dealing with everything a judge would be supposed to deal with, like reading petitions, documents, and other legal stuff submitted by the litigants. Type orders and other legal documents, which will get our initials, submit the text to their supervisor, who will check if everything is okay, and then either get the judge's signature on it or, if something is wrong, correct it and then get the signature. In almost every court, the judge doesn't even read what they're signing if they didn't type it, since they're supposed to trust the supervisor they directly appointed after all. There are, of course, exceptions. If something submitted is very important, or it involves complex matters, we must send the case files directly to the supervisor. And if it's incredibly important, to the judge, who will then read everything carefully between hearings and their other work. If we sent everything directly for the judge's consideration, a huge bottleneck would be created and no one would have any work. One wet behind the ears lawyer who showed up at our counter a few years ago, however, didn't seem to understand that it's a judge's prerogative to delegate whichever tasks they may see fit. The moment she opened her mouth, I knew she would be trouble. She had the classic get me your manager tone, which I'm sure everyone is familiar with. She also emphasized every last word in her sentences. One last thing before the story, everything here is digital, so when we submit something to someone, we actually just move the digital files in our system from one queue to another. Everyone, even judges, is mandated to obey each queue's order, unless something is urgent. The parties in this story are as follows. Me, a smiling, zealous, and upright clerk. Supervisor, the closest thing I have to a boss. Awesome, non-confrontational man, who loves to maliciously comply and pretend like he didn't. The judge, aloof and busy. I've only seen her at our office like 3 times. Doctor important. She'll talk to your manager and she will have your job, probably. The story starts in the morning of a 10-hour day for me. At this time, the courthouse building is closed to everyone but lawyers. There she comes. Blonde, mid-40s with an impatient demeanor and her bar ID in hand. She waits 30 seconds before barking, "Is there no one to serve me?" I get up. Me, "Good morning. Doctor important. I need to talk to my initials and I need it now." Now, that never happened before. No one ever bothers about the initials on files. They just want to talk to a clerk. Me, "That'd be me. What's the matter?" Doctor important, "You were the one who typed this order, right?" Me, "Sure. Is anything wrong?" Doctor important, after a scoff, "Of course there's something wrong. You typed it, not the judge." Me, and what's wrong about it?" Doctor important, "You're just a clerk. You can't possibly do a judge's work." Now, not only do I do part of a judge's work, I probably know more about that kind of order than my judge herself, since it's a menial job with which she doesn't bother. Her case, she made a very abusive contract with a client, who then didn't pay her what she expected to be paid, 80% of the client's monthly earnings for 2 years, and she was pro se filing for losses, with a claim of urgency. My order? Not urgent. Citation to be served via mail. The very first step in a lawsuit after the initial claim. My supervisor heard the drama brewing and came up to us. Supervisor, "Everything is made under the judge's supervision, doctor." Doctor important, "I don't care. I want to talk to the judge and have her read my petition." Supervisor, "I read your petition, and D-Prox followed the correct procedure." Doctor important, "Is he the judge? Are you the judge?" Me, "I wish." Doctor important, after a scoff, "He is so rude. Can't you do something about it?" Supervisor, completely ignoring her remark, "No, he's not the judge and neither am I. What's the matter?" Doctor important, "Oh my God, can no one here understand such a simple thing? I want the judge to read my petition and issue an order." Supervisor, "You mean the exact same order D-Prox issued? I checked and she signed?" Doctor important, "Yes, because then it will be an order issued, checked, and signed by a judge." Me, "The only thing that matters is the signature though." Doctor important, "What?" I thought she would burst. She got red, and she started ranting about public workers' incompetence, how our taxes are funding our laziness, and how is her right as a citizen to have the judge read her petition. While she's ranting, my supervisor looks at me, and I can see the malicious compliance brewing. We wait patiently until she stops repeating the word absurd every other sentence. Supervisor, "Okay, doctor, I think I understand now. You want me to put your case files in the judge's queue." Doctor important, "And do it fast. It's very important. I'll come back in the afternoon to check if she read it." Supervisor with a huge grin, "Sure, ma'am, please do." Now, my judge hates to be bothered with a passion. When someone enters her office, be them workers or lawyers, they better not be wasting her time with something my supervisor or one of the clerks could have dealt with. Just so you can get the picture, we celebrate her birthday in our office and she never shows up. She pays for the cake and the celebration, but she doesn't attend. Me, you're not actually gonna send it to the judge's queue, are you? Supervisor, she did ask it, didn't she? We're hereby forbidden to touch the case, no matter how many requests she sends, unless she gives up on her claims. The dreaded judge's queue. Most lawyers do their best for their case not to end up there. The judge's queue is meant for complicated matters that make a case come to a halt, not urgent matters, which is a separate queue. It's about matters that will require the judge to pore over the entire case's file while consulting every law known to man. It's so low priority that at the time, that queue's first case in line got there 1 year ago, and that is a very good date, considering some judges have their queues last 3 or more years. So my supervisor sends it to the judge's queue, and we go back to work. My judge arrives. We only know that because she logs into Skype, and my supervisor gives her a head up about Dr. Important. She replies, I'll talk to her. My supervisor shows that to me and we share a look. This is very rare. The judge would normally reply, don't let her near my office. By 3 p.m., when our counter is full of litigants and lawyers, Dr. Important comes back. She pushes people on the queue and screams she has very important business with the judge. My supervisor quickly walks up to her. Supervisor, your case is in the judge's queue now, doctor. Dr. Important, did she read it yet? Supervisor, please follow me. She'll talk to you now. Now, this part of the story was told to me by my supervisor, so I'm paraphrasing his paraphrasing. They went upstairs, with Dr. Important complaining about everything in the building. The handrails are too high, the steps are too big, etc., and shaking a copy of her complaint around. My supervisor knocks on the judge's door and opens it. Instantly, Dr. Important's demeanor changes to a very sweet and smiling lady. The judge, yes, how may I help you, doctor? Dr. Important, your honor, I humbly request you to read my case. The judge, didn't you read it, supervisor? Supervisor, of course I did. It's for losses in a lawyer contract. Dr. Important, it's very important because... The judge, it's not important at all. Dr. Important, but it's urgent. The judge, not urgent. Now, this was told by my supervisor who likes to tell stories, so take it with a grain of salt. He said the judge took the copy of the complaint off Dr. Important's hand, read the first 3 sentences aloud, said not urgent at all, crossed out the big bold urgent typed above the claim, and returned it to Dr. Important. The judge, anything else, doctor? Supervisor, she demands you to read her entire complaint, your honor. The judge, is it in my queue? Supervisor, of course it is. The judge, I'll get to it then. Anything else, doctor? Dr. Important, can my case go back to the regular queue? The judge, I'll get to it and then see if it needs to. Some say Dr. Important is still waiting for the judge to read her case to this day. The second story is, bank department manager wants me to work harder, not smarter. Circa 2010, I was working an afternoons gig at a local bank, in part to complete an internship class for my coursework. The job entailed running batches of checks through a massive check scanner, manually running a tape, using an old calculator called a 10 key, with a printing function to make sure the checks match the deposits, and then hopping over to a computer to correct any errors on the teller or customer's part when the deposits were made. After the bank closed, 3 p.m., I was also the one who would stay and print out customer statements and run a long list of processes on multiple machines to update everyone's accounts with the day's transactions, upload the information to the website, back up and run tapes on all the bank's data, and sort and file through end-of-day reports for the different department managers to review the next morning. I would then lock up the bank and go home. In hindsight, quite a bit of responsibility for a college student, but it was a hometown bank. Now, my manager was a classic Karen before the term existed. She managed through fear, tried to cover it with small talk and banter, and didn't like anyone to shine except herself in the department. My two coworkers, full-time bank employees, would always discuss how terrible it was to work for her full-time. Anyway, I was raised to be respectful and work my hardest, which to me meant trying to be as quick at my job as possible, thus saving the company time and money. The closing duties I described took anywhere from 1.5 to 4 hours to complete, depending on which batch of statements were printing and how often the crappy printers jammed. After about a month of doing this every day, I realized how much of this time was due to the checklist I had been trained with. It was doing one task at a time, when actually more than one process could be done at once, many times way out of order of the list, but you had to understand everything's part to really see this. I set about making these efficiencies, and brought my time down to 0.5 to 2.5 hours after 2 months. I thought this would make my manager happy, but nothing was said about me getting out of there faster, and so I just kept on doing my job as best I could. Fast forward 2 more months, and this bank is updating its servers to allow for real-time banking. Previously, unless I updated the website each night, balances and transactions wouldn't show up. They brought in 2 large server cases into the office I worked in, but it took another 3 to 4 weeks for the actual hardware to come in. Since the old servers were still installed, they set the empty towers right in the middle of our office. Now, our office was a very long room, the statement printers on one side, and all the computers I had to work on each night at the other. Remember I said the printers jammed a lot? With all the computers and servers on my end of the office, I never could hear the beep telling me they had jammed, but I could see the red error light. This had historically been my little check. Every few minutes I'd turn around to make sure the printers hadn't jammed. I made sure I did this because every minute they weren't printing was another minute I'd be working. The statements took longer to print than the rest of my duties combined. However, the way they placed the empty server towers blocked my view, forcing me to get up and walk halfway to the printers each time to make sure they were jammed. So I simply turned them 90 degrees. Since the front and backs were full of air ventilation holes, this allowed me to maintain my line of sight, saving me and the bank time. Once again, I thought, great idea. No one is using these yet, and when they do, they won't be in that location anymore anyway. In hindsight, I should have known better. I came in around 2 p.m. after classes the next day and noticed the towers were turned back. I thought that was odd. Why would anyone turn them back? I asked my coworker, and she told me the manager was peeved I had touched them without asking, which as I've learned later in life was fair enough, but still an overreaction. I asked had they being turned messed up some workflow I wasn't thinking of. But no, she hadn't even noticed them until about 11 a.m. when another employee mentioned they had been turned. So her reaction was pure malice for not having been asked. When she saw I had come in, she pulled me aside and asked aggressively why I had touched them. So, thinking this was my chance to highlight my efficiencies, told her all I had done in an effort to make the closing routine more efficient. That was evidently the wrong answer. I was instructed to do the checklist exactly how it was laid out, with no changes whatsoever, because that's how it's supposed to be, even though I had been doing it my quicker way for 2 months already with no downsides. With regard to the printer, she told me to stop being lazy and just get up and walk to it to check on it. Cue malicious compliance. I stopped caring about speed, followed the checklist to a T, and unless I had somewhere to be, didn't worry about checking on the printer very often. If it was still printing after my closing checklist was done, I could always read or do homework at my desk. Wouldn't want to be efficient with the bank's payroll after all. Suffice to say, it went back to taking 1.5 to 4 hours per night and costing the bank much more money in my checks. Good for me, I guess. Shortly after, I found a job working in an electronics department at a superstore and switched over with 2 weeks' notice. There wasn't time to train a new person, so that manager had to take over the night routine until a new one could be found. During my last day, I took it upon myself to try and give her some constructive criticism and how her management style affected me and stopped me from caring about my job. I'm not sure if it was effective, but at least I got it off my chest. I ran into one of my former coworkers at the store a few months later, and evidently someone else had out and out told my manager she was a vile and mean person, and she was probably going to heck for how she treated people. Part of her Karen persona was being very religious, and this seemed to have scared her into at least some meekness, at least according to my former coworker. Thank you for watching. Have a nice day.